For science.
Hi, I'm Neil deGrasse Tyson, and this is Rising Stars.
And we're talking today with Yancey Strickler, co-founder of Kickstarter. And it's responsible for enabling 100,000 projects to have raised more than $2 billion.
That's correct.
What were you thinking? How did this happen? How did you just extract $2 billion from people's pockets and redistribute it?
It has surprised us. Uh-huh. I mean, the idea for Kickstarter came from my partner, Perry Chen. In 2001, he wanted to throw a concert in New Orleans. He did not have that money, but had the thought of, what if I could put the idea for the concert online? People put up a credit card, and if the show sells out, everyone's credit card is charged, and like the show happens. And if nobody cares, nobody pays, nothing happens. And then he and I met here in New York City in 2005. He was an artist and a waiter, and I was a rock critic for The Village Voice. And we met at a restaurant where he worked, and he shared this idea he had with me, and so we decided to start working on it. If a project raises its funding, if they raise their 100 grand, we take 5% of what they raised. If they don't, we take nothing. And simple as that. It's about 40% of projects reach their goal. The average project raises 6 grand or so, but you know, the most a project raises is 22 million. The smallest is probably 50 bucks. But probably the meat and potatoes Kickstarter project is someone raising 15 grand to fund a documentary or to make an album. But in areas like hardware or games where there are massive fan communities, those are projects where you'll see 100,000 people backing. Whereas for an album, it will be more like 100 people backing. And it's quite utopian. I remember for many years going around and pitching investors or whoever with just this idea. We had nothing built. We just had some mock-ups of what the site would look like. Yeah, people really didn't get it. There's not a lot of enthusiasm. Not a lot of enthusiasm.
What's your favorite project that didn't get funded?
Oh, that didn't get funded. Wow. Early on, there was a police sketch artist who launched a project who wanted to draw a sketch of you and like your friends and had this concept of combining faces until creating like the aggregate face of you and your entire social circle, but as like a police sketch drawing, as if you're like a wanted murderer. This is what police sketch artists
this
think
is the
about.
The amalgamated face of you and your friends.
Yeah, exactly.
Whoa.
But yeah, most projects that are funded are overfunded and often significantly so.
Oh, projects okay. Wait. So if you put a, I need this much, and people just keep giving money because they want to. Piece of the action. So that just grows the scale of the project.
Yeah, we don't put a limit. We had debated whether to put a limit. And we just thought, well, we don't have to, because like why would anyone support over the amount? Like what, you know, this person says they need 8 grand, people give 8 grand.
Right.
And I think our third week we had a project blow past its goal on its first day. And it was the first time we had to design the site around the idea of things exceeding 100%. But we didn't anticipate the level of generosity that would be there.
You must be one of the most hopeful people in society.
Absolutely.
Because you see the best of everyone.
Absolutely. Probably the project that has been most special to me was one very early on. A woman named Emily Richmond, who's in her early 20s, wanted to sail around the world by herself. And so I paid 15 bucks. In exchange, I would get a Polaroid sent from her trip. That was all it said.
Oh, that's cute.
And like at a year and a half later, I get a strange envelope in the mail. I open it up, I unfold this map, and written on the map is a letter where she describes sitting on this island in the South Pacific, and at the end took the Polaroid, tucked it in, and mailed it to me from Papua New Guinea. Like it's not just the thing, it's a connection to the person, it's an experience, and it's knowing that, yeah, here's a young woman just sailing around the world because that's what's in her heart.
With your donations through Kickstarter.com.
Use Kickstarter to make a fan-funded old.
Sorry about Kickstarter.
We are not shooting for realism.
There's some household brands today that you Kickstarted. Oculus Rift?
Yeah.
Make a pledge and help us change gaming forever.
Yeah.
That you had something to do with that?
Yeah, Oculus started on Kickstarter. So did Cards Against Humanity. The last 7 years, there has been an Oscar-nominated Kickstarter-funded movie. 7 years straight. And it's a model, this model of funding things has a very long history. You know, we think of the first Kickstarter project as being in the 17th century when Alexander Pope translated the Iliad from Greek to English for the first time. And to do that, he got monetary support from 700 subscribers who in exchange got their name in the front of the first edition and a copy of the book when it was done 4 years later. This is a Kickstarter project. This is how the Iliad, as we still read it today, was created. This is how traditionally mankind has produced culture or like reached for the stars, literally and figuratively.
I'm persistently enchanted. Every time I see a community of people wanting to put up their own microsatellite,
yeah.
They just want a piece of the action.
There's been hundreds of those.
Hundreds.
You know, we've had it anywhere from kindergartners through scientists from JPL.
Jet Propulsion Labs.
Yeah, working to put things into orbit or out of orbit. And one of the core concepts of Kickstarter was to create a universe, a whole other economy, where things could exist just because people were excited. A lot of ideas contort themselves to fit a profit motive, to fit the demands of the market. But like, what does the world look like if ideas can exist in their purest form just due to people's passion and enthusiasm? And that seemed like a world worth trying to create.
I just realized typically, at least in my field, we would apply for a grant from NASA or the National Science Foundation, both of which are tax-based agencies.
Yeah.
And if you voluntarily allocate your money, you're a much stronger participant in the money you're not otherwise spending on yourself.
Yeah. Well, there's examples of, I know people like asking for extra money to be given to NASA on their tax form at the end of the year, but unfortunately it doesn't work that way.
Wouldn't it be interesting if it did? If you allocated money according to your own wishes rather than what Congress wishes, I think the country would look very different.
For sure.
Some of the NASA naysayers, they'll say, why are we spending money up there and not down here? And I say, how much money do you think we're spending up there?
Yeah.
Oh, 5%, 10%, no. And then I tell them it's 0.5% of their tax dollar. Like if you colored in a stripe on a dollar, 0.5% of that dollar doesn't even get you into the ink as if you color it in. So it's one thing to fund kindergartners, and it's a very different thing to say, all right, I want to crowdsource a mission to Mars.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a whole other scale.
Yeah.
Is that within the reach of the generosity of the public?
Yeah.
You think you can lay down $100 billion?
I mean, probably not me personally.
I know, but it's...
but humanity, yeah. You know, this is the exact sort of project that would actually do quite well. If you think about, actually, the Statue of Liberty was funded in a method like Kickstarter. The French built the statue, but there was nowhere in New York to put it. So the New York Herald Tribune got New Yorkers to each put up $5 a piece to fund the pedestal that the Statue of Liberty stands on.
Oh, the French didn't give us the pedestal. Oh. We got a statue. All right, guys, what are we
going to put? Where are we going to put this? Yeah. So New Yorkers did that then, putting up 150 grand to have a place to Statue of Liberty. That's 150 grand in like $1870,
right.
Which is probably, yeah. And I think that there are ways that this system could aggregate that level of support. And
so let's just do some fast numbers. We have 300 million people
in
the country. If everyone gave a dollar, that's $300 million. If everyone gave $10, that's $3 billion.
Well, the people can put up $50 million and then, you know, Buffett and Bezos and Gates and all, they can take care of the rest or something. But this could be like the greatest collective action by man.
Other than awaiting the next really cool project to be funded, what's in your future?
We became a public benefit corporation. This is it's basically somewhere exactly between being a for-profit company and a not-for-profit, where you are legally required to produce a positive good for society, and you draft a charter saying what you are to be held accountable for. You know, we declare a commitment to artists and creative people working in less commercial areas. We donate 5% of our after-tax profits to arts and music education programs and to organizations fighting to end systemic inequality. We pledge to never use legal but esoteric tax avoidance strategies. And we basically just tried to carve out of what do we think it means to be a company in the 21st century, and one that is conscious, one that is woke, and that, you know, has a sense of belonging to a greater society and doesn't want to extract from that society but wants to build upon it.
What kind of a company are you?
Well,
we build a society instead of extract from it.
You know, we think that this is not a hippie granola thing. We think this is the future. We think that this is what all companies eventually will aspire to be. Yeah, it's awesome. It's a lot of fun.
So you're giving creative people a conduit to visibility and success so that they can participate in enhancing civilization, rather than being subject to the judgment of others who know not what they criticize.
Yeah. Love it, yes, please.
Okay.
Let's do it.
Dude, excellent.